Hey guys, it's Jar here, and welcome to The Beginner's Guide. I heard that it's similar to the Stanley Parables, which is another series I'm doing as well. So we're going to kind of mix them up a bit and see how it goes. So it's Longer Games March, I guess. I don't know. Let's just start. Audio is on. Loud and clear. Control with WASD and the mouse. Got it. Sorry if you don't like that noise.
Hi there. Thank you very much for playing The Beginner's Guide. My name is Davey Reedon. I wrote The Stanley Parable. And while that game tells a pretty absurd story, today I'm going to tell you about a series of events that happened between 2008 and 2011. We're going to look at the games made by a friend of mine named Coda. Now, these games mean a lot to me. I met Coda in early 2009 at a time when I was really struggling with some personal stuff, and his work pointed me in a very powerful direction. I found it to be a good reference point for the kinds of creative works that I wanted to make. So just to start you off, this is, I think, the first game he ever made. It's a level for Counter-Strike. You can walk around here, by the way. And mostly it's just Coda learning the basics of building a 3D environment. But what I like is that even though he starts from the simple aesthetic of a desert town, he then scatters these colorful abstract blobs and impossible floating crates around the level. And of course, it destroys the illusion that this actually is a desert town, and instead this level becomes a kind of calling card from its creator. It's like a reminder that this video game was constructed by a real person. And it kind of makes you wonder, what was going through his head as he was building this? This is what I like about all of Coda's games. I mean, not that they're all fascinating as games, but that they are all going to give us access to their creator. I want us to see past the games themselves. I want to get to know who this human being really is. And that's exactly what we're going to do here. So, it's 2008, Coda starts making these games, and he never releases any of them. He doesn't put them onto the internet, he just makes them and then immediately abandons them and they sit on his computer forever. And I think he really understood this image of himself as a recluse. At one point he jokingly renamed his computer's recycling bin to Important Games Folder. So, you know, this was just how he worked. He tended to crank them out one after the other without even really pausing to try to understand what he had just made, until suddenly one day he just stopped. In 2011, that was it. He made his last game, and then he hasn't made another one since. And that's why I've taken this opportunity to gather all of his work together, is because I find his games powerful and interesting, and I'd like this collection to reach him, to maybe encourage him to start creating again. And if the people like you who play this also happen to find his work interesting, then I'm sure it'll just send that much stronger of a message of encouragement to Coda. So thanks for joining me on this. If you have a particular interpretation that I haven't mentioned here, or if you just need to get in touch, you can email me at daveywreden@gmail.com. Okay, that's about it for introduction. Let's take a look at Coda's first proper game. As each game is loading, I'll show you the date that it was completed. This first one was made in November 2008.
Okay, so I might not be talking a lot because I obviously want the person to talk. So this will be a long series, as will the Stanley Parables be, so please sit back, relax, enjoy, grab a nice bottle of water or tea or coffee or more, you know, grab some tea, grab some water, grab some milk, grab whatever you want to drink, grab some popcorn, sit back, relax, and enjoy this ride that we're going to take together. Whisper Machine status activated. Jeez, that scared me.
This game is called Escape from Whisper, and it's one of the more generic games you'll see from Coda.
Escape from Whisper.
Hostile alien life forms inbound.
It kind of looks like this game was abandoned mid-development. For instance, you have this gun, which you'd think would indicate that there are supposed to be monsters or enemies somewhere, but then clearly there are no enemies anywhere. You can't even reload the gun when you run out of bullets. But ultimately, we don't really know. Maybe Coda thought that actually it was complete the way that it is. And I think that we should talk about his games for what they are, rather than for what they're not.
Enemy force neutralized. Begin ship evacuation.
Pretty! I want to go out there! I love the stars. One thing you guys might not know about me is I love outer space. I love stars. I love staring at them. They're just so beautiful. So this is really cool.
I love how you can see the bottom of the universe from this room.
It's very cool.
Apparently, this space station has a labyrinth on it. Sure, I don't know. There's really no reason for it that I've ever been able to discern, so in the interest of time, I'm just gonna skip you on past it.
Oh, thanks.
Okay, this is the part that's interesting. The game has this narrative about the Whisper Machine and how it has to be turned off, and then you get to the engine room.
Hey! You there? In the engine room. You could save us all. That beam is powering the Whisper Machine. We could disrupt it by introducing a great enough heat signature. If you... your body could stop the beam. It's so much to ask, but for all of our lives, would you do it? Could you give yourself?
So, basically you're asking me to die.
Let me pause here for a second. What you just experienced, stepping into the beam and then dying, is probably what Coda had initially intended when he was developing this level. But when he first compiles and plays it, something goes wrong. There's a bug somewhere. And this is what happens instead.
I'm alive. I'm just imagining there's a body though. Okay, why won't it let me die? Whoa. This
is
amazing.
The beam causes you to start floating. And this is an important moment for him. Because yes, this is technically a glitch, but Coda identifies something human about it. Like how small it makes you feel in the face of this larger chaotic system. Or this floating could be the afterlife, a peaceful place, juxtaposed against all of the hysteria that you've just had to traverse. I don't even know. I have no idea what he was thinking, but what's clear is that after making this, something lodges itself in his brain. He wants to do more of these really weird and experimental designs. So he stops work on this and moves on to a stream of tiny little games that go in all sorts of directions. Let's go ahead and take a look at the first game he made after leaving this one behind.
November 2008. I was 8 years old when this was made. The past was behind her.
Yep. In this game, you can only walk backwards.
That's cool. I like that. So I can kind of move around.
So it's a short and relatively minimalist experiment combining motion and narrative. It is less advanced than the previous game, but actually it seems to be more focused, more complete. Coda is trying to give it a unique voice rather than simply basing it on a pre-existing trope.
Look at this. Oh, you go that way. When she stops and look, it becomes clearer. But if the future is always behind her, how will she find the strength to confront it?
It's a short little thought, it says what it wants to say, and then it ends. Didn't need anything more
than that.
That's
cool.
Which to me is why it works, because it gets out quick. Okay, next one.
Drink break. That is mad cool, I like that. Oh, grass. You are now entering. Entering what?
And that's it. Okay, the meaning of this game won't be clear just yet. Please be patient with me for a few more games, and I promise you'll see what makes it interesting.
Okay, I trust you. You're now entering. Entering what?
Oftentimes, Coda would put bizarre titles like this one at the start of his games. I wish I'd known him at the time that he was making these early games. He would really only talk to me about his work as he was making it. Once he stopped work on a game, like, that was it. It was dead to him. And I don't agree with that at all, but what are you gonna do?
This is really cool.
You've been slowed to an absolute crawl, the door at the top of the stairs opens. So why, if Coda's not showing these games to anyone, why bother opening the door at all? Well, to show you, I'm modifying the game here so that when you press enter, it'll bring you back up to full speed so you can enter the door for yourself.
Why'd you have to modify it, though? Obviously, there's a reason he did that. Hold on. You were kind of talking people down from pursuing normal game where you just scream and talk about everything to keep playing. The key in one game unlocks another door in a completely separate game.
And nice and filled with little ideas for games.
Here's the camera.
Coda would often tell me that he didn't mind if people thought of him as cold or distant. He said that he knew that he was actually a vibrant and compassionate person, but that it takes time to really see that. It can be a very slow climb to get there.
You want to shove inside your body. How do you get out, though? Oh. January 2009. Ready, set, fish. Okay. I can get behind that. I like fishing. Something tells me this isn't about fishing. He likes these oranges. I give him that.
Well, this is new for Coda. It's an actual puzzle. Go ahead and see if you can solve it.
What? I don't get it. It's so cool. It's like all this dark mist. Watch. So light. I need to figure out a way to close this door.
Don't forget that solution, because we're going to see this puzzle again soon. We're going to see it a lot.
One door closes, another door opens. I get it. This is pretty.
So
I like
this. That seems
to
be it, right? You walk down a corridor, you solve a puzzle, you get to the end. Simple enough. All right, now I'm going to modify the game again so that when you press enter, it'll remove all of the walls from this room.
Whoa. What the heck?
How about that?
Huh?
There was more to it than we had any way of knowing. I actually find it funny that this game comes after the stairs game, since they essentially convey the opposite idea. So, in the stairs game, a dull exterior concealed a rich interior. And then, in this level, a dull interior hides this fantastic outer world. Either way, I think that the point is the same, is that most of the time, you don't get to know what you're missing. or even that you're missing anything. That's not your role as a player. So if your role here is not to understand, then what is it?
This is amazing. I guess the role is to play. It's the same game again. You're not...
Aha! So, this, combined with the entering game from earlier, tells us that Coda believes his games are connected somehow. It could even be that the stairs game and the puzzle game are literally connected in between this and the entering game. There's a bigger picture that all of his games are meant to play a role in, some larger meaning that we won't be able to grasp until we've seen all of them. And once we have, we can step back and start to understand what exactly that bigger picture is.
Interesting. I like that concept. Multiple games give you a bigger picture. That's quite cool. The Great and Lovely Descent. I like this. I like all the different games. It's like, you gotta have... It's simple.
Let's talk about video game development for a second. Every video game runs on what's called an engine, which determines what the game can and cannot do. So in other words, the engine is a set of tools for game development.
The Streetwise Fool.
To make all of these games, Coda is using an engine called Source. Like all engines, Source has certain things that it does well, and it has certain things that it does poorly. One of the things that it does very well is boxy linear corridors. That's why so many of Coda's games are set in these large, flat, empty rooms, is just because he's working with what the engine does well.
I can see that.
The tools available to the creator shape what kinds of creative work they're going to end up making. You might consider paying attention to the architecture in Coda's games, to notice how they seem to stem from an engine that's very good at producing linear, boxy corridors.
Something tells me that's going to change. When I get through the door. Let me through the door. Okay. There's another door. Let me through these doors. Alright, David, what do you want me to- Oh. Door's open here now. Had a feeling it would change. Whoa. But this is a cool change. Still the same engine, different way of using it. What happens if I just fall? I want to get to about over here. Keep on. Okay, I might have cheated the system a bit, but I mean. Interesting. These are all rounded now. Okay, why? Why have it almost cattle-like? With creepy sound effects. Okay. Who wants me to go through?
This prison, funny enough, in Coda's original design, the door stayed shut for a full hour before letting you go. If you don't mind,
Whoa.
I think we're gonna skip that.
That's
this is something
cool,
that he and I used to argue about a lot. You know, whether a game ought to actually be playable. Whether it means anything if no one can get through it. And I would always defend that, you know, all this work goes into the game, why not make it playable and accessible? And so we just got into heated arguments over it, and there was one time that after one of these conversations, he went home, and a day or two later, he sent me a zip file entitled Playable Games that was full of hundreds of individual games, each of which was just an empty box that you walked around in and nothing else. Believe me, I played every single one of those just to find out if there was like a gag hidden somewhere. But there wasn't.
Good friend you are. find that so pleasing when like it goes from dark to light. Huh. Those three dots pop up. I wonder if that's his symbol. Like Dakota's symbol.
It's the puzzle again. With the exact same solution as the last time.
I mean, I guess that's good to know.
There's still no clear indication of what makes this puzzle so special that Coda is going to return to it over and over. But I promise, I'll share with you my interpretation very shortly.
It's his connecting piece. You know, he said that he wanted to connect the games. I guess that was his connecting piece. Clouds. I'm sorry, I love anything to do with this guy. I'm not a hard person to please, to be honest. Listen. You there.
Here, Coda begins using a kind of dialogue system that he fashioned out of the engine's chat capabilities. Use the 1, 2, 3 buttons on your keyboard to respond.
What was up there? Yes, there was a world stamped with whiteness. Yes, there was an enormous prison I spent hours in. Yes, there was these floating colored blocks. There's a world above. You've been there. That's more important. Did you have to get through a puzzle with two doors and switches? Yeah, I did. Again, perfect. Please tell us how you solved it. Tell us the solution. Tell us how you get to the other side. I remember. I say, trust me, you don't want to go over there. I like how it changes when they speak. We need to get there. Do you understand? It's the most important thing in the world. We have to escape this prison. There must be an ending. I promise you, there is nothing I want more. How odd. The same three people. Yes. How did you get, let's just go see the puzzle sometime. I mean, it's not to be solved, but you can sit in the black space in the middle. Who are you? Just hang on a bit, there in the blackness for a bit. May not like it at first, but it'll grow on you eventually. Who the hell are you people? The textures in the wall were really
And so
cool.
We make one last descent down to the final floor of the level.
Looks like a college dorm area.
It's a lamp.
I mean, it kind of looks like a university.
Okay, I can't tell you quite why, but for some reason, Coda fixates on this lamppost. It's going to appear at the end of every single one of his games from here on out. I'll tell you what I think. I think that up to this point, you know, he's been making really strange and abstract games with no clear purpose, and maybe you can only float around in that headspace for so long. Because now he wants something to hold on to. He wants a reference point. He wants the work to be leading to something. He wants a destination, which is what this lamppost is. It's a destination. We're going to see it in the work as well. His games are just going to become a lot more cohesive, a lot more fully developed, with more of a clear idea behind them. And as we go, that idea will get clearer and clearer and clearer.
Interesting. So his lamppost is kind of like his source of light. Because everyone goes to light. Whether you like it or not. You know, flies go to light, mosquitoes, la-da-da-da-da. So, it's saying go to the light, in effect. This game is connected to the internet. As you walk around, you can leave notes. All notes you see are left by other players. Aww, hi! You're a cute little speech bubble. Nice room. Not. Well, that's rude.
So first off, I'm sure you can deduce this, but this game is not connected to the internet. All of the notes that you're gonna see have been written by Coda. This was actually the first game of his that I ever played. This was shortly after I met him at a weekend game jam in Sacramento, where I grew up. I saw him working on this very level, and it was just so different from anything that anyone else was doing. So right away I was like, I have to be friends with this person. In retrospect, I think I was probably a bit too pushy trying to get his attention. I was over-enthusiastic. But he was very gracious about it and very patient with me. And I cooled off eventually. Oh, feel free to skip over any of these notes if they're not doing anything for you. Nothing extra is gonna happen if you read all of them. Either way, to me they convey a sense of loneliness. I see this person who's filled with thoughts and feelings and beliefs and has no way to express them except as scattered and unheard voices in a game that wasn't meant to be played.
I like those speech bubbles, they're kind of cool.
But it's ironic, isn't it? That in playing this game and seeing how alone Coda often felt, that we get to know him better and actually kind of connect with him. And I have to be honest with you, this idea is really seductive to me. That I could just play someone's game and see the voices in their head and get to know them better and have to do less of the messy in-person socializing. I could just get to know you through your work. I think this is why I always liked Coda's games so much, is because it felt like they let me have that connection. I felt as though he was inviting me personally into his world. And then I feel less lonely too.
It's like getting an insight into his brain, if that makes sense. Like, these are all his thoughts and feelings. This is like his real life diary, in effect. You know, what he thinks, he writes down. What he feels, he writes down. All his hopes, dreams, and emotions. Everything. This is his diary. Meg's game clues door can open the door. Who says the door needs to be opened? That's a lot of notes. I'm not gonna read them all, I apologize, but as we go past you can read through. That painting though. How can he make so many notes? That's amazing. When you talk to someone, this is a note. It's just unbelievably amazing. Someone who has the time and effort to do all of this. It kind of just makes you think, why are they so sad? That's all the notes put together. Oh, you can crouch, cool. I don't think you can run. I don't know, but you know what? That's okay, because we can just venture down this long path together. Sorry, I thought that was a room. My apologies.
At the end of this level, we're going to see the puzzle again. And here, I'll tell you what I think the puzzle means. Each of these games represents an idea that was on Coda's mind at the time that he was making it. And the puzzle is a way of closing the door on a previous chapter of his life before moving on to the next one. In each of his games, after exploring a theme that, you know, he might find difficult, Coda can then place this puzzle that he knows has a reliable solution, he understands exactly how it works, and so it gives him a simple mechanism for moving on. And because there's this dark area between the doors, a space between spaces, before you move on, you get to pause. Just for a moment, a few seconds to reflect on and let go of the events that led you here. To step back and connect the pieces together. To grasp at that elusive bigger picture.
I get the doors now. Whoa. Typewriters, I miss them. I have one. Are you there? Please say something. It could be anything, I just need you to say something. Talk to me, please. Why haven't you... So I should please speak. Hello? So this happened between May and June. Typewriters are amazing things. So, I have one. But yeah.
Okay, this one is tough. It's gonna kinda just spin its own wheels for a few minutes. Hang with it.
That's good to know. There's a well. And a very weird house. Whoa, I take that back. I love that. This music, though. Hey, there's that grass and cobble thing again.
This is it. The whole game. And there's nothing that's particularly interesting about it. You just walk to the end of a hallway. Except, for some reason, Coda gets really fixated on this prison that has all of this modern furniture. And I don't know why, but he decides he needs to revisit this prison. He's gonna start over, use the same assets, turn it into something else. Okay, cool. Here's version 2.
But the well was what we saw out there. Hey! What the hell? What furniture added on the center of the room? A fridge. Okay. How about along the wall of the room? Let's put a picture of a horse. I think we should light up this room a bit. I don't think it matters. Because it's just the same stuff repetitive. A table, you need a table. Tables were invented in 1935. I'm pretty sure none of my choices are making any differences. Who are you? What exactly are you doing this from? I'm gonna say number 2. Because it doesn't matter what I pick.
There's a bit more to this one, but still, it's not really communicating anything. It's kind of just weird for weirdness' sake.
Why?
So, okay, he throws it out and starts over. This time he comes at the prison idea from a different direction.
Hello, please walk away. Is he alright? This guy will enable you to escape from any prison. Follow instructions carefully. Take care and remember each step. First, click on this table. Good, go to the photo frame and turn it slightly. Now turn the floor lamp in this room off and then turn it back on. Floor lamp? Now go to the left side of the sofa. Move it over a bit. Finally touch the sleeve. Oh, shelf. Can't read. That's it, it's a real prison. The escape will now open and return to the start to take it back to your prison. What? Return.
And of course, now the table is gone and you can't begin the chain of events to escape.
Oh.
Here's a version where there are no bars, but you can't actually get to the well. And then a version where the inside of the prison is the outside and the outside is the inside. Let me just blink you real quick through a few more of these. I mean, he really unloaded on this prison idea. There's nearly a dozen of them. Personally, I think it's awful to watch this. To see a person basically unraveling through their work. And for what? Like, at what point do you just go, maybe there are game ideas other than this prison that I could be working on? But Coda doesn't have that voice telling you to stop. That particular mechanism of defense against yourself. Without it, you just spiral. And so he keeps going and going and going and going and going. And then he hits on something. And he likes it. And that's it. He's done. He stops making prisons. This is the very last version of the prison game that he created. And the reason I think it works is that the prison is not actually in it.
Okay. Oh yeah, I'm really liking this game. It's so cool. There's a telephone box. Okay, we've come out of this house into this... what looks like to be hedges, supposed to be a maze. But it goes dead straight. It's hard to see. Yeah, it's a telephone box. Hello? Who is this? Hey, it's me. I'm you from after you escaped the prison. What? You're me? So you were trapped in the prison too?
It's a conversation. And so this is what Coda wants, is to be able to talk to someone, to share what's on his mind,
aww,
and to get some good advice from someone who knows. But the irony is that even in this scenario, you're still talking to yourself. You know, all of these games so far are Coda talking to himself.
So he's kind of just have no one to talk to. So he's legitimately talking to himself. He's on the brink of insanity. You know, it's like when you have no one to talk to, you kind of talk to yourself and you kind of... anyway, yeah, you know what, today I'm going to do this, 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 and this. Alright, cool, you know, we got this team, let's do it. The team is just you. You know? Because it's not insanity to talk to yourself, but... like, I talk to myself personally, but I mean, I guess all YouTubers do, but I don't class myself as a YouTuber yet, but... it's just kind of like... everyone talks to himself in some way, shape, or form. Personally, that's what I think. So yeah. But yeah, definitely I feel like he just needs to get up and talk to someone. I like how it's multiple games in one, trying to get you to help out his friend. You know, it's as simple as that. It's nothing extreme, nothing long or short, it's nothing random, it's to the point, but lately obvious.
I can see why he considers this a fitting conclusion to the prison games. After all of the obsession and frustration, just to be told by someone you can trust that things are going to be okay, wouldn't that be nice?
So he feels like he's stuck in a prison, and he needs someone to tell him that everything's going to be alright. But he has no one to tell him that everything's going to be alright.
So what would it look like if Coda wanted to make a game about talking to someone other than himself?
That would be fascinating.
To me, this environment is meant to represent Coda's puzzle, with the two doors on either side and a dark transitional space between.
Clean. Well, my goodness, I'm glad as heck that you showed up now. Thought I might have to clean this entire house all by myself. And right miserable that would have been. Everyone knows loneliness hands make lousy homes.
You'll notice that the quality of the art is a step up from previous games, including this new and improved chat system, which he started using from this point on. From here on out, he begins putting much more effort into the visual polish of his work. And this particular game took 2 months to create as a result.
How do you end up this job? Friend dragged me. I was particularly desperate for cash. Turns out, I never felt so good doing something for money my whole life. Never did like clean my home I've gotten some demons. I ain't ready to face yet. Speaking of demons, someone put this couch all in mess. Would you come straighten out the pillows? Sure, but I mean, what's wrong with you, dude? Oh dear, looks like someone's put a drink on the couch. Maybe mop that up as long as you're there. Feel compelled to share an incredible cheesy personal insight. Would you be okay with that? Yeah, talk to me. I'm always here for you guys to talk to me, no matter what. No matter what you think it is. Come on, Clean, talk to me. Clean? No, it was stupid, sorry, never mind. Clean, talk to me. Okay, these dishes need to be washed. Why don't you come do that? Last I checked, the tub needed cleaning. I might scrub it down as best I can. They need to be perfect, we're just all human. Are there books still scattered in the bedroom? If so, it'd be cool to put them back on the shelf. Is he trying to get all his thoughts in order and this is the way he's thinking about it?
After the intense set of prison games, this house cleaning level almost feels like cleansing. It's the moment after a particularly difficult or traumatic experience where you just need to let it sit and digest inside of you, and eventually cohere into something meaningful.
Darling, Yuli, among all those, a few of them will stick out as truly wonderful, beautiful experiences. None of them will be the ones that were easy. Just something to think about while you smooth out the rug in the
bedroom. I know that Coda really liked this game. Of all of his work, actually, this was the only one that he called me up to ask me to come over and look at it. This was during a period of a few months where he was, like, grossly happy all the time. Just walked around with a constant smile on his face.
When I said I really cheesed, I was going to say that it occurred that to me that someone's house looks a lot like one soul. Take care of it and you clean it. Take care of it and it takes care of you. Don't worry, I know it sounds weird. I get it. That's just... I guess it's just weird to say. Oh, whoops. Wrong one. Anyway, so housekeeping. Let's keep doing this.
Glad
he just
this.
Does it on repeat.
I'm glad he found some peace. But, of course, it can't last. The music stops, your companion is gone, it's time to leave. The door at the top of the hill is now open as well. Again, you can't stay in the dark space for too long. You just can't. You have to keep moving. It's how you stay alive.
Okay. Oh, there's that lamppost again.
Which is the whole point of the puzzle doors, right? That sooner or later you have to pick up and move. I really thought that was the point of it.
September 2009. I just turned 9.
This one
I'm
gets
love
a bit
at members only prices. Why'd you come here today? Cause mom said so. Was it to improve your life? Was it get a better job? Probably. Was it to make your relationship more meaningful? Don't have a relationship. Nope. Came here to become perfect. I don't want to be perfect. I want your friends, the people in your life to look at me. Wow, this person's better human than I am. Can I not take this course? Can I leave? I don't want to be perfect. Perfect is not something we should be striving for. Compared to whom you feel useless, selfish, ungrateful, and tend to make perfection is in your grasp. Any questions on how we do this? Not how to do it, but how we do it effortlessly. This is easy. It's so easy.
About halfway through the game, the perspective shifts.
Whoa.
And you play as the teacher. And suddenly, you discover that your teacher is just as bigoted and afraid as you are. Oh, and also you can move around the classroom now.
Keep doing the back ones and see what happens. So black is a bad thought.
I felt pretty hard for this one. I feel like it's one of the most relatable experiences that you can have. To assume that some other person is perfect and totally fulfilled in every way, and completely miss all of the little flaws that make them painfully human. I think about this game a lot these days.
I like that, that's cool. January 2010, it said it stopped in 2011. I think that was it. I can't remember, I apologize.
This one took a lot longer than all the others for Coda to make. It was 4 months between this and the last one. That's twice as long as it took him to make any other game before this, and it's not like it's particularly complex, so I remember I found that a little strange at the time.
In this scene, you'll be playing as me. We are a gathering of professionals. First, we'll start out leaning against this wall. Good, stay right there. The woman across the room in this chair is a professional photographer of animals. And your dream is your dream to photograph animals professionally. It's your one chance to learn something from it, to gain some success. Go and say something. Wise. Hello. Hello, that's it. That's not a controversial conversation. You need to actually converse with her. Be a human being. Do it again. How do you start a conversation then? No, that's not what I would say to her. Completely missing the tone of the conversation. I was reserved, but I knew what I wanted. I was confident. For some reason, it was just one moment, but I was confident. Maybe it's you need better feel of the saying. There are a lot of people around us. I'll give you props to work with. These cones that bounce when you touch them represents the people nearby. Now talk to her again. Ah, I want to be a ping. What? You must have worked really hard to get where you are. You're messing it all up again. You figure out if the conversation gets personal that quickly. You don't realize how important this is to me. I never get an opportunity like this again. Everything's riding on. Oh, I get this. I want to try something. Try stepping back from the stage. Not personal speaking, what is it? Public speaking. That was being afraid of public speaking. Yeah, okay, yes, now this is working.
The game ends with this eerie premonition of what's going to happen next in Coda's life. The solution to social anxiety, to fears of having to perform and having to chase success, the answer for Coda is to withdraw, to hide himself away. Which is what leads to scenarios like the stairs that slowed you down several games ago, where it just becomes harder and harder to access Coda's inner landscape because he keeps retreating. He just keeps backing away from possible connections to anyone other than himself. And to be honest, I didn't consider it very healthy when I first played this game. You know, it looked to me like he was trying to justify the idea of just disconnecting yourself from the world. And that wasn't what I wanted for him or for his games. Because I feel like a lot of his games are inviting me to connect with this person, to bring him closer. But what can you do? After this, Coda went off and took another 5 months to make a new game.
He's taking longer and longer because he's getting more and more anxious and stressed and finding it more and more difficult. Mobus tip. To play this game properly, you must keep your eyes closed. click to begin the game. Okay. What's going on? Captain, what can we do? Help, I can't see anything. What's going on? Okay. There's a giant door coming to us. Hey, people, calm. The SS Whisperer. I need to get up the stairs.
You should probably open your eyes if you haven't already. It's pretty much impossible to solve otherwise. And there is a solution, by the way.
The only way to stop is to speak honestly. I can't keep making these. Yeah, that's it. That's the truth.
Like I said, I was getting concerned. First off, he's never been this explicit in his work about exactly what he's thinking. So where's that coming from? But then even weirder, his work has potentially stopped being an outlet for him. Not like he's having trouble iterating on ideas, but he literally just can't think of new ideas anymore. And in person, he was being a lot more distant than usual. Like, you know how sometimes a person will just deflect anything that you say in order to keep themselves disconnected all the time? It was that kind of thing. Here was the point in my relationship with Coda where I really started to wonder if he needed my help in some way. His games are going to get more desperate from here on out. After this game, it's almost 6 months before he finishes something new.
Interesting. He's really struggling. Whoa. Nature. I love nature, man. Is that a person? How lovely. It's been a long time since I've talked to anyone. What's wrong? You look lost. So it's kind of him talking to Victoria, talking to this David guy, I guess. I'm gonna just keep hitting random buttons. I'm trying to find this engine that uses to protect me to start it again. Wait, you're looking for a machine? I think I know where that is. It isn't far. You have to take me to it.
If the last game featured Coda talking explicitly about his creative frustrations, this one turns it up to 11. Now, put yourself in my shoes playing this. Here's a friend whose work is exhibiting signs of struggle, frustration, anxiety, depression, even. And yet, still, he keeps making games. He keeps throwing himself into the grinder even when he clearly doesn't have the energy for it anymore. Why? What is it for? Because from my perspective at the time and just what I knew of him, this was a result of how isolated he was. He was in his own little bubble, just sitting at his computer all day, not really showing these games to anyone, not releasing them onto the internet, and so he didn't have anyone outside of himself to connect with. He had no outlet to ground himself on.
So he just basically feels like he's kind of isolated, has no one to talk to. So the only way he can is to talk to himself.
You can't talk yourself out of loneliness. It doesn't work that way. You can't be the one writing both the questions and the answers. Then there's no movement. Then there's no circulation. If all of your anxieties are being channeled into your work, then if the work ever fails, you have no backup and you're just going to crash.
Okay. So, it's just kind of out of whack, lost and confused. And the crying is kind of like the emotion, I guess, they're going through. Okay, so lying somehow helps?
Seeing this game at the time that he made it, it looked really unhealthy to me. I was watching him do this to himself, and I hated it. I hated seeing him so trapped. It's like, video games are not worth this amount of suffering. This is someone I really cared about. And I used to get so much joy out of seeing him create. For him to suddenly become angry and frustrated like this, it was the worst thing for me. I don't know.
So basically,
this is what I felt at the time. I don't know how else to explain it. I wanted it to stop more than anything. I had never felt so rotten. I needed more than I had ever needed anything for this to stop. But it didn't stop. After finishing this one, Coda takes another 7 months and comes up with a new game.
Drink break. Everyone have a cup of your tea or coffee or Coke or cola or water or milk or whatever you're drinking. The machine. This guy must be going through a lot. Well, this person. But I'm glad to see you arrive safely. We've captured the machine and is waiting for you. Interrogation whenever you like. I intend to be quick, I guess. There's even someone called the press. So you might have a bit of attention this one. Also, you might think you should know about it. It's called Coda. Coda isn't a person, it's a machine.
And of course, it's the machine.
Wait, hold on. So are we saying that David is talking to Coda and Coda is a machine? So David might be going through something. Apologize for leaving. Why? What is happening in this game? He's legitimately talking to himself. My friends. It falls on me to deliver bad news. The machine refuses to deliberately hurt us. But we will find a way to live without it. We do not need its games. Let's play its retribution. Follow me, we'll destroy the machine or everything the machine has created. Guess the machine. The gun's back. But why? Where's this machine? Where's Dakota?
Remember, you can click to fire the gun.
Oh. It's breaking the machine. Dakota, I'll make sure your word dies here. Okay, so I can't shoot the ground. That's good to know.
So now the work is becoming self-destructive. And I'll tell you, at the time that I first played this game, shortly after he made it, here's what I'm thinking to myself. I'm thinking that Code is stuck in his own head, and that it's having a very negative effect on him, and that all he needs to do is just start showing his work to people, to get some actual feedback on his games. It might get him out of isolation. And so, as I'm thinking this, I realize that I could be the one to initiate it. Because it would never occur to Coda to start actively soliciting feedback, so what if I did it for him? If he could see the difference it would make to have more actual conversations with other human beings, would that bring him out of his mental spiral? Would it give him confidence in himself? Would it bring meaning back into his work?
So I'm legitimately destroying everything Coda's ever made. What a weird and fascinating concept.
So I started showing Coda's work to people. I took this one, and the islands which you just played, the theater, the notes, the house cleaning game, and some of the prison escape games. I brought them to people that I knew and trusted. I asked their opinions. And the great part is that they really loved his games. You know, the point of it all was just to give him some external reference point, but they genuinely loved his work. There was nothing for him to be afraid of.
Light post machine. Whoa. Put down your weapon. No.
Can you see why I felt like this was the right thing to do? Because it's the thing that I always feel like I need, to be told that my work is good, that I am good. When someone really connects with a thing that I've made, when they see themselves purely in my work, there's nothing that feels better. And I got to give that very same feeling to my friend. I did something... I really felt like I'd done something good, like I was a good person. I felt like there was a friend who was in trouble and was unhappy and maybe didn't like themselves, and I could fix it. If I could give him this gift, maybe I could fix the problem. When they told me how much they enjoyed his games, it was the best feeling. It was the absolute best feeling. It made me feel so happy. So beautifully, beautifully happy.
Something's odd about this.
So anyway,
Guru really is Dakota.
Coda finishes this game, and then really he just kind of takes off for a while. So this is June of 2011, and I didn't hear anything from him for several weeks, I guess. And so out of nowhere, one day I get an email, and it's got a private link to a new game of Coda's. This one is called The Tower, and to my knowledge, it's the last game that Coda ever made. So let's take a look.
Who really is Coda? That's my question. Is Coda the actual machine? Is it his figment of imagination? Who is Coda? I think that's the question. The tower. Okay, the orange is back.
And this is where I have trouble saying anything meaningful about Coda's work. Because more than anything else, the tower just feels distant. It feels like it's trying to distance itself from the world. It's a very cold game.
I don't think so. But the warmth of the orange was there.
This room actually has a maze in it. Except that the walls of the maze are invisible. And then every time you touch one of the walls, there's this awful flashing and noise. So the experience is really miserable. The game goes beyond not being meant to be played. It actually seems to despise the player for trying to play it at all. But I do want to show you the rest of the level, so when you're ready to continue, press enter and I'll put a bridge over the maze.
Wall. 128. I wonder if that means something. Yeah, because it's the same number repetitively. I just wonder if it means something.
And to be fair, it's not like this is the first game that's needed some modification to be playable. Like the house cleaning game. You know, that one used to actually loop the cleaning chores and you just cleaned a house forever. I had to cut it off so that you could exit the house and the game would actually end. But that game had an idea that it was actually trying to communicate. What's the deeper idea behind the invisible maze? The only way past this challenge is to randomly guess the 6-digit code. Like the invisible maze, it's frustrating to me, because it's the opposite of everything else that Coda has made. It doesn't encourage thought or engagement. It doesn't ask anything of me, except a lot of my time. If I could have reached him during this time, then maybe I could have asked him, but I couldn't. I still don't really understand why this is here. I'll put the code on the ground for you here, though, so that we can move on.
Is that it? What is it? 15161. What? 15 1 6.
The switch to open this door is actually on the other side of the door, meaning that it's literally impossible to solve from this side. So even if you somehow brute-forced your way through the first two challenges, and you got to this point, there's actually just no way to progress. And it's scary for me, the idea of Coda cutting himself off entirely, just saying, you know, that's it, that's the end of the conversation, not giving me any way to fix the problem. I feel like a failure, I guess, when I can't fix the problem.
Let me through.
But I can open this door for you, so let me do that. Was I a failure for not understanding this game? I mean, I don't know why I would be. It's not like everything needs to have a solution, but I feel it somehow. I feel like I failed, and I don't understand why. I remember, it's June of 2011, I'm playing this for the very first time, and as I'm playing, I'm thinking to myself, I don't know this person. I have no idea who this person is. It wasn't the guy I knew, it wasn't my friend. I had come to so many conclusions from looking at all of his work up to this point, and then suddenly none of them... I had been trying to, though, that was the thing. For years, I was trying to get to know him, to understand who he actually was and what he stood for. I asked him so many times to please just tell me what his games mean to him. I asked him please to tell me what the three dots mean. And he wouldn't.
Yeah. This is a very interesting concept. Like, it's all been bright and colorful. And then you have this.
I just felt so strongly that if I could have connected with him, that if I could have somehow made his work my own, that I would finally be once and for all happy. It was that I needed to see myself in someone else. I needed to be someone other than me. But he stopped and left. And it felt somehow like I had failed.
I'm wondering, because I remember back we had like the grass section and like the wood. And one of the questions was in the notes, what's with the concrete, W2F? Is it because of this? That's my question. Was the concrete showing that his insanity was coming more and more through? To the stage where he felt locked in?
I'm the reason that you stopped making games, aren't I? It's because of what I did. I poisoned it for you.
It was his fun little thing and you ruined it.
I don't think I ever told you this, but when I took your work and I was showing it to people, it actually felt... It felt as though I were responsible for something important and valuable. And the people who played them, they treated me like I was important. They really listened and cared about what I had to say. Even though I was showing your work, it was... I felt good about myself. Finally, for a moment, while I had that, I liked myself.
Davey was the one adding the lampposts. It was his way of trying to brighten the thing.
And then you stopped.
Try and brighten up
the spirit. And I didn't have anything left to show people. I just had to be with myself. And as soon as that happened, there was no feeling at all. Nothing. Less than nothing. What does that mean?
He's not broken. It's his game.
I'm afraid that I did something really stupid because I don't like myself.
He does this because it's simple.
That's why I'm releasing this collection of your work. Is because I haven't been able to find any other way to reach you. I've tried everything. And so a part of me has hope that if I put this compilation out into the world, and if I put my name on it, that maybe enough people will play it so that it'll find its way to you, so that I can tell you that I'm sorry. I know I screwed up. If I apologize to you truly and deeply, will you start making games again? Please, I need to feel okay with myself again. And I always felt okay as long as I had your work to see myself in. I mean, is something wrong with me? Because I know that I did an awful thing, and I'm doing it again right now. Like, I'm showing people your work, but I can't stop myself from doing it. That's how badly I need to feel something again, like I'm an addict. There has to be something wrong with me. Can I apologize? What if I tell you I was wrong? Will that work? Will that fix it? I don't know. I don't think it will, but there's nothing else that I can do. Just tell me what you want. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Please, start making games again. Please help me. Please give me some of whatever it is that makes you complete. I want whatever that wholeness is that you just summoned out of nothing and you put into your work. You were complete in some way that I never was. I want to know how to be a good person. I want to know how not to hate myself. Please. I'm fading, and all I want is to know that I'm going to be okay.
You're going to be alright, Davey. Give yourself time. It's as simple as that. Everyone needs time. Yes, he's mad. You went against his wishes. What do you expect? Don't go against someone's wishes. The epilogue. This is brighter. It looks like London. Or like a train station in Paris, actually. The train station.
More. More love, more praise, more people telling me that I'm good. Always more. It's like a disease. Solution.
It's not a disease, it's humanity. Humanity wants to feel good. You want to feel great, feel awesome.
I guess if someone had told me ahead of time that he just really enjoyed making prison games, maybe I wouldn't have thought he was so desperate. I wouldn't have told so many people that he was depressed. Maybe he just likes making prisons.
Well, that's the reason. You spread around rumors, it's not going to go well. Never spread rumors about someone when you know they're not true. Or even if you think they're true. You shouldn't be spreading, you should be helping. Spreading never helps.
Even now, the disease is telling me to stop. Don't show people what a shitty person you are. They'll hate you.
Why all the sand? Where am I? Hello? This is weird. It's like I'm underground. It's like I'm under his levels. But
if I knew that my life depended on finding something to be driven by other than validation, what would that even be? It's strange, but the thought of not being driven by external validation is unthinkable. Like, I actually cannot conceive of what that would be like.
Maybe Coda is sane and you're the messed up one, Davey. But who knows? I guess we'll see.
What now? I think I need to
get you drove your friend away.
I'm sorry, because I know that I said that I would be here and I would walk you through this, but starting to feel like I have a lot of work to do. I have a lot that I need to make up for, and so I'm just gonna... Okay.
That's the thing. He's leaving, but to fix what he broke. When you think about it, he legitimately broke his friend. His friend was having fun making prison games and making these games, like, you know, how would you like if your friend came up to you and just went, why are you so depressed? Why are you so upset and mad at the world? It's not something you should be doing, you know? Yes, we need friends to tell us things, but not always that. Because we could fall down a deep dark hole and could never get up. Again. Like I just did. Or we can get someone to lift us up. I'm like, I need to walk forward. And that's the point. Now we're back at the train station, except Davey's gone because the lamppost is not there anymore. So, Davey thought he was leaving a light behind, you know, helping people out, supporting his friend. But it turns out he was just making it so much worse. In more ways than one. And he didn't realize that. You know, we're only human. We only do things a certain way because that's all we know what to do. We don't really know how to do anything else other than to do it. So I think this is quite a powerful video. I'm very much into powerful messages and supporting people in every way, shape and form, no matter how they see themselves. So this is definitely interesting and very good video. It's good for the heart and brain. I wonder if this will work. Yeah, it glitches. Just the way he intended it to. Whoa, that's a huge maze. Like, you know, how amazing is that though? Sorry about that, my iPod needs to shut up. Thank you. My apologies. You know, we feel like we're trapped in a maze constantly, but sometimes we just need to see the stars above to help us get through. And the stars are always helpful. But look how cool, it's like really close, and you look over there, it's like, it just looks like spots. How cool is that? I think we just let it ride. I'm not overly sure. You know what? That is okay.
Turn back.
Wow. Ah.
Turn back from this cave. You said let me prove.
This project would not have been possible without the following individuals. Matthew, Ryan, Haley, Richard, Jesus, Linda, Jack, and Andreas. Or Andre. Turn black. Written by
and miles by. And miles. And you're so tired.
Additional thanks.
But I know that you're strong. So turn back.
Thank you guys so much for joining me on this journey. It's definitely a roller coaster of emotions, but thank you for joining me. We're gonna just see how this ends before we leave. So let's just wait a little bit longer. I know. Let's wait. And that is how it ends. So thank you guys so much for watching this. I hope all of you are feeling alright, and I hope you can find the light in your dark tunnel. So, yeah. Anyway, thank you guys so much for watching. If you liked it, let me know in the comments below. And yeah. Anyway, dry out, see you guys in the next video. Sarcasm out. Let's bring for a very sarcastic hug. Bye bye. See ya. Let's take a deep breath. And out. Now go and eat some yummy food. And hug some.